The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... Come in. Welcome. I'm E.G. Marshall. When the candles are out, a philosopher once said, all women are fair. And if this wisdom were more often taken to heart, much of the trouble we must suffer in this world might be averted. However, the sun does shine for half of each 24 hours, and despite what you may think, it's during the light and not the night that the most serious mischief of women is committed.
The fact is, you lied to me.
Technically, that's true.
Technically?
Certain questions must be answered with a lie. Therefore, if you don't want to be lied to, don't ask that type of question. Don't force me to lie.
No one is forced to lie.
Everyone is forced to lie. To ease the aches and pains of life with some soothing, relaxing falsehoods. You may object to my telling a lie occasionally, but you couldn't live with me if I told you the truth constantly.
Our mystery drama, The 1,000-Pound Gorilla, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by Sam Dan and stars Mandel Kramer. I'll be back shortly with Act One. It has been written, nothing is more dangerous than an idea, especially if it's the only one you have. Ideas, therefore, should be like amoebas, constantly churning about inside, splitting up and multiplying themselves. Otherwise, let us consider a man named Franklin G. Wilkinson. Mr. Wilkinson is 40 years of age, in the prime of life, in the best of health, and perhaps a rarity on this troubled planet of ours. A truly happy, contented, and fulfilled human being. You may ask, what is he doing on our show? Wait.
Hello?
Wendy, darling?
Frank!
Everything all right?
Of course. What could go wrong? Darling, what are you doing?
I'm about to have lunch. Then I have to survive another 9 holes of this tournament.
How's it coming?
Splendidly.
I'm so happy your game is on.
No, as a matter of fact, it's way off, which is wonderful because you're supposed to lose to your clients, you know.
Darling, I hope you're not involved in any chicanery.
Oh, no. My game is just naturally off. Look, I better hang up before the buffet is all gone. They're a very hungry group.
Remember to watch your diet.
I'll try.
And remember, I love you.
That I can never forget.
You mind if I join you?
No, not at all. Just sit down your plate, Mr. Harkins.
It's Haskins. You spelled the name wrong on my badge.
Oh, my name, as you can see, is Wilkinson.
Yes, I know.
Well, you're doing well today?
Par for the front nine.
That should be good enough to win.
If I don't stage my usual collapse, I can go out in 36 and come home in 50.
Well, I hope not.
Well, I must say, your company does a marvelous job. Great course, fine lunch, plenty to drink.
Well, it's just a way to thank our clients for their business.
And a great way to get them to give you more, huh?
Well, we like to believe we get that on merit.
It's funny.
What is?
This little chit-chat we're having. It's not the way I thought it would be.
I beg your pardon?
I was wondering, should I or shouldn't I come over and talk to you? I don't know if I'm doing the right thing.
I don't understand.
Well, I'm in a very awkward position. I could keep everything to myself, say nothing.
About what?
When you were named General Sales Manager of Consolidated, I looked you up in Who's Who. And along with your name was hers.
Whose name?
Your wife's.
How does my wife come into this?
Well, there it was, Franklin Galt Wilkinson, married to Gwendolyn Coombs.
Well, what about it?
It's a very Welsh name, Gwendolyn Coombs. Wouldn't you say?
My wife's grandparents emigrated to this country from Cardiff.
Yes, I know. I know. I had the honor of meeting the old gentleman.
You're saying you knew my wife?
Oh, yes.
Oh, well, how well did you know her?
As well as you do. I was married to her.
You were what?
I should say I knew her better because I'm not married to her anymore. And you are. I see you don't quite know what to say.
Well, she never...
She never told you that she was married before, huh? I shouldn't wonder.
Why are you telling me this, Mr. Haskins?
Perhaps, I want to save your life.
I don't think I care to pursue this conversation.
She is going to murder you.
Sir, I must ask you to leave.
Now, she tried to murder me.
She what? Oh, come on. I mean, if this is a joke, it's in terrible taste.
It is true.
Wendy?
Now, if you don't leave her, she'll kill you. That's why I left her.
I see.
Don't you want to know more?
No.
Don't you want to know why I made that statement?
No.
I want to help you.
Mr. Haskins, get up. This very moment, and leave. Leave these premises quickly. Leave here quietly, but leave.
Hello?
Wendy?
Frank, darling.
Honey, this thing, it ran later than we all expected.
Oh?
Yeah, a few little matters came up, so we decided to just sit around here and straighten the situation out over some dinner.
Oh, I'm sorry, darling. I know how you hate to have these things run over into the evening.
Yeah, well, it just happens sometimes.
Well, finish up as soon as you can. I really can't spare you.
Yes, yes, I will.
Frank, is something wrong?
Huh? No. What could be wrong?
Hurry home, darling.
Well, here's something you don't see every night.
Oh, hello, Dick.
The much-married Franklin G. Wilkinson all by himself drinking alone. The uxorious Franklin G. Wilkinson.
Oh, come on, cut it out, huh?
Uxorious. You know, that's a rather unpleasant-sounding word. And yet it describes the happiest of situations. A man completely devoted to his wife.
I'll buy you a drink.
Oh, pour me the usual, Eddie. Oh, is she out of town?
Is who out of town?
Well, who do you think? Wendy.
Of course not. Can't a man pause at his club after a hectic day?
No, ordinary man, yes, but not a man who has his Wendy to go home to. That, what does she see in you? She is such a lovely young thing, and you're such an old grouch.
I'm not that old, Dick.
I'm jealous.
Of what?
Oh, you know, of you. You know, I dream of writing the great American novel. And what is at the heart of any great novel? Huh?
I wouldn't know.
A magnificent love story. That's why you're one up on me.
How's that?
Well, I wouldn't have to create one. You, on the other hand, actually live one. You see, mine is a fantasy spun out of my imagination. And yours is living, breathing reality. There isn't a guy I know who wouldn't trade places. Now, boy, you have got it made.
Dick, I think you've had one too many. You want me to drive you home?
No, I'm not drunk for crying out loud. But what I'm saying makes sense. Look, are you ever afraid it could be a dream and you'll wake up one morning?
No.
I noticed you were chatting with a fellow named Haskins. George Haskins of Leslie and Fuller.
Yes, do you know him?
What do you think of him?
We were just chatting, that's all.
Oh. I'm surprised they let him out.
Let him out?
Yeah. Expose him. You know, he's crazy.
In one way?
A number of ways, I guess. He has these, I don't know, fantasies. You could ask me why Leslie and Fuller keep him, you know.
I do ask you.
Well, it's the old gag. Where does a 1,000-pound gorilla sleep, huh? Anywhere he wants to.
But what does this have to do with Haskins? He doesn't impress me as a 1,000-pound gorilla.
Well, he is a 1,000-pound genius. He came up with a process that cut their production costs 20% last year. And you know what that did for him.
Yes, yes, I know.
Well, for some reason, I guess he just wanted to come to this tournament. They couldn't say no to him. But I guess Haskins seemed to behave himself.
Well, what would Haskins do if he weren't behaving himself?
Who knows? Probably corner some guy and, you know, make up some fantastic story.
He would?
Hmm?
About what?
I don't know about anything at all.
But what sort of story?
Well, something that could cause a lot of trouble.
In what way?
All right. Something like this. In your case, for example, he would find out that you had this wonderful relationship with your wife, so he'd make up a yarn to the effect that that she's actually a foreign agent.
Oh, come on.
Yeah, it's true.
Well, I mean, how could he ever expect me to believe it?
Well, he has got this very earnest manner about him.
Still, such an outrageous yarn?
You know, sometimes you plant a little seed, and who knows what can grow, huh?
Why does he do it?
Well, I told you. He's a nut.
Oh, darling.
Oh, I woke you. I'm sorry.
No, I'm glad. I wanted to be awake when you came home, but I'm so sleepy.
And so beautiful.
Did you enjoy the tournament?
I would much rather have spent Saturday with you.
Did you meet any interesting people?
The usual crowd. The freeloaders, guys glad of a chance to get away from their wives for a day. And the expected quota of characters, you know. Matter of fact, there was one fella. He was just fantastic.
Oh, what way?
Almost every way. He was a fabulist. I looked that up. It means a person who tells the most extravagant stories. I will say he had me going for a while.
Well, what did he tell you?
Oh, he spun a very involved yarn.
Sounds interesting. Or was it?
Mostly, it was kind of scary.
How?
He was a rather tall man, I'd say, about my age, maybe a few years older. Brown hair, a scar on his cheek. His name was Haskins. George Haskins. He's an engineer, I understand.
You know, I think it's time you came to bed.
George Haskins. A rather unique person.
Darling, do you suppose you could turn off the light?
I tell you, I won't forget him in a hurry.
Oh, good night, Angel.
I wonder if he's married. If he was ever married. I wonder what life must be like for the wife of a man like him. Darling? Wendy? Good night.
Good night. Yes, good night with the question unanswered. Although, who says it's a question? True, he gave her a chance to answer, but suppose she is completely unaware of what he's talking about. Then again, suppose Mr. George Haskins is on the level. You must wear tough knee-length boots and carry a stout stick. We shall have to walk through a nest of vipers. I'll be back with Act Two shortly. Doubt, if you will, the being who loves you, woman or dog, but never doubt love itself. That may all be very well as poetic sentiment, but love can only be expressed in terms of the being who loves, or is supposed to, love you. And if and when that being, that person, is ever proved false, then the truth must also disappear from love forever.
I waited for you, my love, in vain. The chiming of the tower clock announced that time had flown again. And shall I ever hear you knock?
This is in payment for last night, I should say.
Coffee?
Thank you, dear.
Oh, there is so much beautiful poetry in the world. Why should it lie dormant and dusty in a book on the shelf?
I don't know.
It was meant to be a part of our lives, of everyday existence.
Wendy, about yesterday, last night.
Darling, I realize there's a world out there, and one must accommodate to it, especially a man in your position. But I wish I could have you all to myself.
I'd like to chuck the whole business.
I know.
What are your plans for today?
I have a great deal to do in the garden.
Darling, don't you think... Well, I mean, shouldn't you get around a little bit more?
Why?
Well, I just think it would do you good to be with people, you know. I mean, a lot of the men were telling me that their wives were trying to get you to play tennis and have lunch, things like that, with very little success. And most of them are really very nice.
Yes, but what can I get from those people?
I'm not sure I know what you mean.
Darling, our lives are very short and precarious at best. We should spend our time with things and people and in places where we can be enriched.
Mm-hmm. Well, if that's how you feel.
I love you because you sustain me, darling. And my garden sustains me. Not just because of the things that grow there, but because it's a world of its own with so much interdependence. I know this sounds silly.
No, I understand. I've also got a 9 o'clock appointment.
Frank, I love you.
I'll be home early. Very early today. Yes, Miss O'Reilly?
A call from a Mr. Haskins.
Haskins?
He's from Leslie and Fuller.
Miss O'Reilly, tell him I'm out. Then come in here. Close the door, please.
What is it?
Miss O'Reilly, I do not wish at any time, under any circumstances, ever to see or speak with Mr. George Haskins of Leslie and Fuller.
I'll make a note of it.
Do more than that. Make a career of it. This is going to require all your skill, experience, tact, and finesse. It's your number one priority.
Hey, you busy, Frank?
Oh, come on in, Dick.
I just come down from the board meeting.
Oh, how'd it go?
What do you want me to tell you? Bit of a problem. As we broke up, old man Beresford collared me.
Oh, the big one himself. Huh? Mm-hmm. You must be doing something right.
Well, one thing I know is that you're not doing something right.
What are you talking about? I'm 6% above last year.
It's Haskins.
Haskins? What does he have to do with anything?
You're ducking him. Is it true?
Oh, wait a minute. Who says that I'm required to...
Frank, I am on your side. Now, is it true?
He's a creep. And I don't want to have anything to do with him. Now, what business is that of Beresford's?
It's worth $10 million to the corporation.
What is?
The Leslie and Fuller account. And that's what they bought from us last year. Now, this year, it'll go even higher. Evidently, Haskins complained about your attitude to Jim Leslie. Leslie had some words on the subject with Beresford.
I still don't see why I'm concerned with it.
To Jim Leslie, Haskins is a 1,000-pound gorilla. To old man Beresford, Fuller is a 1,000-pound gorilla. And to you, Beresford
is a... All right, but why has it become a corporate matter?
Because they use so much of our number 7 compound. Now, Haskins wants to know about our marketing strategy.
Why?
Because he thinks it should be coordinated with theirs.
He's an engineer. What does he have to do with marketing?
He is the 1,000-pound gorilla who sleeps wherever he likes. Frank, I know he's a completely unlikable fella, but he never did anything to you. Anyhow, pass the word to Miss O'Reilly. The Iron Curtain has to come down.
Mr. Haskins on the telephone.
What can I tell you, Miss O'Reilly? They broke my sword.
I can see the blood from here.
It's a dark day.
The first of many.
Put him on.
Mr. Wilkinson?
Yes, Mr. Haskins.
I wonder if you're free for lunch.
Yes, I think so.
You must be my guest. 1 o'clock at the club.
And how is dear Wendy?
Mr. Haskins, I've come here for a business luncheon. Now, you may be the best customer my firm has, but I am not required to discuss my personal life.
Now, don't take that tone with me. I'm the best friend you have.
How do I know you were even married to my wife?
Why don't you ask her? You're afraid to open it up. You don't look so hot.
What do you mean, I don't look so hot?
You appear to be a bit, peaked. A tired look comes first.
Mr. Haskins, what's your game?
It's a commentary in the world we live in. Every action has to have an ulterior motive. We simply cannot conceive of an act that's performed without hope of gain or profit. What's the angle? Where's the gimmick? What's this guy trying to put over?
All right, what? You tell me.
I just want to help you.
Why?
For the best of all reasons. You're a fellow human being.
All right, I'll go along. Assume she was once your wife. Assume she wants to kill me. Why?
For the same reason she wanted to kill me.
And what's that reason?
Part of her nature.
What nature?
You know, there's a poem by Coleridge, Samuel Taylor Coleridge. Her lips were red, her looks were free, her locks were yellow as gold. A nightmare of life in death is she who thicks men's blood with cold. Now, do you understand?
No.
Well, you will. And it really isn't her fault. I don't even think she's aware of what she's doing. Perhaps some ancient malevolent spirit has taken possession of her.
What you're saying doesn't get better, more believable, more possible.
Believability, possibility. What do these things have to do with the truth?
Mr. Haskins.
Just tell me one thing. She mentioned the word sustenance yet.
Sustenance?
Yes, as she said to you, I love you because you sustain me.
I can't recall.
Oh, yes, you can. It's beginning.
Mr. Haskins, I wish you'd leave me alone.
If you saw a man drowning, would you walk away? Or would you try to save him? Ask her. Ask her if she wasn't my wife. Ask her why I left her. Now, yes, you can check the records. We were married in a little town in Northern California. Stewart's Landing.
Mr. Haskins, I just wish...
Leave her. Now, before it's too late. Get out while you can.
We should set up separate rate schedules for... read that back to me, will you?
We should set up separate rate schedules for...
Now, let me think.
Chief, we've been on this one thing for the last 20 minutes. Are you okay?
Oh, I don't feel too good now.
I thought so. Why don't you go to a doctor?
Would you want to put me on a flight to California?
When?
Tonight. Sacramento.
Don't you have a meeting with the board tomorrow?
Well, my report isn't quite ready. We can postpone it.
But the report is ready. I just typed it.
Well, it's incomplete. We have a problem in the Sacramento office. I think I better get right on it.
Whatever you say.
Yes, sir. Help you out?
They said you keep the records here for the town of Stewart's Landing. I need to verify a marriage. It would be at least 10, maybe 15 years ago.
Betwixt who and whom?
A Mr. George Haskins and a Miss Gwendolyn Coombs.
Well, you come with me, we'll look it up. It should be in this cabinet here. Under Haskins. Here we got it. George Haskins, Gwendolyn Coombs. You want to have a photostat of this? Hey, mister.
Oh, no. No, thank you, no.
Darling, you're back.
Yes.
How was the trip?
It was all right.
Darling, are you feeling well?
I'm very tired.
Why don't you get right to bed?
Wendy, I want to talk with you.
Well, of course, but you seem so exhausted. Can't it wait till tomorrow?
No. No, we should have it out right now.
Have what out?
Wendy, tell me, had you been married before? Now that I've asked, I realize what a silly question it could be. After all, if we love each other, what difference need that make? Anyhow, do you suppose you could answer that question? Had you been married?
I never asked you that question.
If you did, my answer would be no. What's your answer?
My answer is also no.
You know, I know this sounds absolutely silly, but are you sure?
Yes.
Well, I guess that takes care of that. No, no, it doesn't. Look, we've gone this far. We might just as well walk the last mile. Wendy, I saw a record of a marriage filed in a town in Northern California between a Mr. George Haskins and a Miss Gwendolyn Coombs. Now, how do you account for it?
How do you account for it? That's not a bad question. On the one hand, we have her spoken word, which says no. On the other hand, we have the written word, which says yes. Can these opposites be reconciled? This is the task we face in the third act. Was it Archimedes or Plato, or possibly Euclid, who said, "You cannot be in two places at the same time"? It would seem to be true on the face of it. Although in this story, don't bet on anything. For example, we have a person who contends that at a certain time of her life, she was in a state of single blessing. And another who insists that she was enjoying wedded bliss. We continue.
Did you say you went to Stewart's Landing in California?
Yes.
Why?
Because I had to find out if you'd been married before.
Why?
Why? I have a right to know.
Do you?
It's important.
If it were a matter of importance, why didn't you ask me before you proposed to me? In all the time we've been married, when did it become important?
Well, the fact is, you lied to me.
Technically, that's true.
Technically?
Oh, Frank. Certain questions must be answered with lies. They just must be.
But it's wrong to lie.
That's right. And that's why if you love someone, you should never deliberately place them in a position where they are forced to tell a lie.
No one is ever forced to tell a lie.
Oh, don't say that. The lie is the cornerstone of our civilization.
Wendy.
How can people live with each other if they don't relax the strains and tensions with constant soothing little falsehoods?
Look, Wendy, I don't care to have a philosophical discussion. I asked you a simple question. Were you married before? You said no. You lied to me.
All right. Ask me the question again. Go ahead.
Had you been married before?
Yes. Well, I told you the truth. Has it made you happier?
Well, why did you feel you had to deny it?
Because it never happened.
Wendy, there's an official document in a town hall.
I don't care about the piece of paper, and I don't care about a foolish little adolescent girl named Gwendolyn Coombs, a 17-year-old girl who stupidly eloped with her high school physics teacher. It was a mistake, a dreadful, dismal mistake. He was crazy.
But still,
he's a terrible kind of crazy man. He is a genius. There's no living with that kind of a human being. If he's a human being.
Wendy.
You met him. You spoke to him. And he said, "She's going to murder you. She tried to murder me. Leave her." He did say that, didn't he?
Yes.
Oh, Frank. Why did you have to bring this all back to me? Isn't this something better forgotten out of my life?
Why does he say these things?
Why do you believe him?
I don't say I believe him.
The morning after we were married, I realized my mistake. I tried to stick it out. My pride was involved. I mean, how could I admit to the world that I'd been wrong? I tried to make the marriage work, but he was impossible. And so I left him.
But I still don't understand why he should say what he does.
Because he is crazy.
But there must be a reason.
There is. His vanity. He was twice my age. Afterward, he had to face all sorts of snickering comments, all sorts of knowing remarks about how he was really too old to satisfy a young girl.
Even so.
And it was true. Where are you going?
I'm going to kill him.
What for?
What right does he have to say and do?
Frank, do you want to make it worse? Do you want to let him destroy us?
I don't care.
You know, this isn't you talking. That's an angry stranger who is temporarily in command of your body.
A man like George Haskins doesn't deserve to live.
A man like George Haskins is like so many people in this world. That's why I hate to go out into it. That's why I prefer my own little universe. Oh, Frank, please. Stay with me. Stay here. For just a little while. Please.
What report, Dick? Well, I'm sure I sent it up. Wait a minute, I'll buzz Miss O'Reilly.
Yes?
You want to come in here? All right, Dick, look, I'll get to the bottom of this thing. Of course I'm okay. Why do you ask?
Mr. Wilkinson?
Yeah, why didn't you send that quarterly report up to Dick?
Well, how could I? You haven't finished it.
Oh, that's right, I haven't.
Something's wrong.
Miss O'Reilly, I want to kill somebody. What do you think of that?
That's a perfectly human longing. Who?
George Haskins.
Why?
Well, let's say he insulted my wife. Of course, I'd lose my job.
You'd lose more than that.
No. Most people who commit murder these days rarely wind up in jail. They plead temporary insanity, one thing or another, unwritten law. Society would forgive me for killing Haskins. But since it would cost Consolidated the Leslie Fuller account, the board of directors would never forgive me. But I have to do something.
Mr. Wilkinson's office.
Is Mr. Wilkinson in? This is Mr. Haskins.
Speaking of the devil.
Make a date with him for lunch. Tell him I'll pick him up.
Where are we headed?
Where?
Have you forgotten? You suggested we have lunch in the country, and then we could drive up to inspect your new processing plant.
That's right.
You're on schedule.
What schedule?
You're becoming forgetful, aren't you? It's part of it. Part of a malaise, a symptom of your growing weakness.
That's enough.
Enough? You're only at the beginning of things.
I ought to...
You ought to what? I know what you're thinking. You want to kill me. Or at least beat the daylights out of me. But, no, you couldn't do it.
Who says I couldn't do it?
How long have you been aware of the situation, huh? 6? No, 8 weeks? It's taken its toll. 2 months ago, you might have handled me, but I don't think you have the strength anymore.
Step outside.
If you insist.
All right, now put up your hands.
All right.
You asked for this.
So did you.
Why?
Oh, I'm sorry. Here, let me help you up.
Get away from me.
Now, isn't this stupid, huh? And if you'd knocked me down, what would it have all proved?
We'll try this again.
Why? You think it's going to be different? You're too slow. You can't hit hard. Your strength is gone. She took it from you.
Don't say that.
It's the truth. She needs your strength. She lives on your strength more and more.
You're just jealous because you weren't man enough for her.
Neither are you.
That's a lie.
She needs all the strength, all the force, all the spirit of life that's in your body. All of it. She can't share it with anyone else.
You're crazy.
Does she have any friends? Tell me, do you have a social life? And what's her excuse? Well, she's just too sensitive for this cruel world, isn't she?
You did a ludicrous thing. You ran away with a high school girl half your age.
She seduced me. And what did I know then? Sure, I was almost 40. But my whole life was mathematics, physics, chemistry. She was the first breath of fresh air. Oh, she was shrewd. I got her what she wanted. I got her out of that house where she was being suffocated by the old people who were raising her.
I don't want to hear any more.
All right. All right, I tried. First, you start feeling weak. Then, the nightmares. Or, are they nightmares?
I thought you were finished.
You see her in the middle of the night. And you don't know if you are awake or asleep. But you hear her voice, her sweet, soft voice. And she says, yes, yes, you love me.
Shut up.
Don't you want to hear the rest of it?
No.
But you will.
Frank?
Yes, dear?
You're awake.
Yes.
Can't you sleep?
I'm just restless tonight.
Oh, Frank, I know you're worried about that Haskins, but please put him out of your mind. We were never married. I know we went through a ceremony, we lived together, but he and I were never married the way you and I are married. Frank, I love you so much. I need you so much.
Now, I'll just have to develop the kind of attitude that allows me to put up with him.
You never have to see him again.
I will if I want to keep my job.
Well, quit your job. And we'll be together all the time.
What do we live on?
What do we need?
Well, there is such a thing as reality.
Yes, darling. And I've already told you. You can create your own. Worry about anything. Just stay with me. I need your strength. I need more of it every day. I'll die without it. I live on your strength. I have something inside me, some force, something. It commands me.
What do you say? Am I dreaming?
I can't help myself, Frank. I can't.
Am I dreaming?
Who's there?
Frank Wilkinson.
Just a minute.
Do you know what time it is? It's 4 in the morning. Now, what's the idea of the gun?
Step aside. I'm coming in.
All right. Well, now what?
Tell me the truth.
The truth?
Tell me the truth or I'll kill you. I have to know.
I have told you the truth. Your life force is being drained away.
How do I know you didn't put it in my head? How do I know it isn't all suggestion?
Oh, why can't you believe me? Walk away from her. I walked away from her. Save your life. Leave her.
I can't.
I thought I couldn't, but I did.
You're lying. You're lying.
And now she's killed us both.
Frank? Who is it?
It's me. It's Dick.
Oh.
Wendy said today was visiting day, so I thought... Was she here?
Who?
Wendy.
Wendy? Oh, she must be in the cafeteria. What time is it?
It's just 1:30.
Well, they'll be coming for me for treatment. But it won't help. I'm dying, Dick.
Oh, that is nonsense.
Don't talk, Dick. Just listen. She's killing me, Dick. She's draining me.
How?
You want to save my life?
Of course.
Then we have to get rid of her. Somehow.
Frank, what are you saying?
Look, I didn't listen to him. But you listen to me. Get rid of her before she drains all the life out of me. Please, Dick.
Sure. Well, can I get you another cup of coffee, Wendy?
No, thank you, Dick. I'm very tired.
Yeah, coming up here all the time must be quite a drain.
It's more than that. Frank is dying, you know.
Oh, well,
the doctor told me straight out they don't know what it is. It could be next week, next month. But soon.
I'm so sorry.
That's why I look tired. You see, I always needed a man to lean on, to draw strength from.
Yeah, well, you know, surely a smart girl like you...
No. No. I don't know what it is. For some reason, I can't live alone without someone.
Hmm? A beautiful girl like you shouldn't have any trouble.
Well, it's not that easy, Dick. I need someone mature, kind, patient, who wants to be with me all the time.
Mm, yeah.
It's late. They'll be throwing us out of here.
Hey, how'd you come up here?
By train.
Well, let me give you a lift home, Wendy.
Not if it's too much trouble.
No. You look all worn out. Nice, easy ride downstate and a relaxed dinner. Should work wonders. What do you say?
You know, Dick, I feel so much stronger already.
And here we go again. Or do we? Shall Dick be victim number 3? Who knows? Perhaps even Wendy doesn't. You must admit it's a rather distressing situation to have a stranger accost you and tell you your wife is in the process of killing you. And how does he know? Well, she once tried it with him. Yes, who says life isn't filled with little surprises? Not me. I may even bring you another one when I return. Actual records of a divorce trial. They had been married for 35 years, almost a complete lifetime. And now he was suing her for divorce. And when the judge asked him why, he replied, "Your Honor, I really don't know this woman." For 35 years, they had shared the same bed and board, and one day it occurred to him that he didn't know who she was. And since she did not contest the divorce, it stands to reason that she didn't know who he was either. The larger question, how well do we really know anyone? Our cast included Mandel Kramer, Terry Keene, and Earl Hammond. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown. And now, a preview of our next tale.
Then what did you do?
I said to her, "Are you okay?"
Well, she didn't answer.
So I, without meaning anything, I put my hand on her, on her body, to rouse her gently. And she just fell across the seat. And then I saw the blood. And that's how it got on my sleeve.
Then what'd you do?
I ran down the road. I saw this police car and... Well, that's it.
And did you see anyone else in the park?
Oh, no, sir.
Now, you didn't see or hear anything that could help us?
No, sir.
And that's your story?
Yes, sir.
Why'd you kill her?
What? What did you say?
Why did you kill her?
This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.